Our second speaker today is Marc Burger, and he's going to be talking about higher tachymeter spaces from SL to R to other Lie groups.
Thank you very much. So I wanted to thank the organizers for the invitation, also for the wonderful way we're being welcomed here and this very enjoyable atmosphere. Okay, I'm going to be extremely classical for the first half hour, and I want to motivate what I'm going to say later on by giving three descriptions, three answers, three ways to answer the same question. And this is the following. So I have a surface. I mean, we're still in dimension two, like in the talk before. And we have a surface which is connected, a priori any surface, and we're interested in the hyperbolic structures. So now we're in the second part of the last talk already, namely, recall what the Poincaré disk is. It's a unique disk in C, and we have the Poincaré metric on it. And this is just to set the notations, and we will call for the first half of this talk G, the group of orientation preserving asymmetries of the Poincaré disk. It is very well known that it is obtained as the quotient of SU11 modulo the center which acts trivially. So now a hyperbolic structure, we are going to think of it as being a, what is called a GD structure on S. That's probably the most basic way to think about the hyperbolic structure. Is right after you learn the definition of what is a manifold with charts and changes of charts, you can insist that these charts take values in the geometry you like, and the changes of charts are just given by restrictions of global isometries. And there you are. And this gives for you immediately a way to measure lengths of small arcs on S, introduce a distance, and immediately speak about completeness. So we will be interested in this space of complete hyperbolic structures, so S. And now, you have this on one side, and on the other side, we're going to have a more algebraic object, which is just the space of all the homomorphisms from the fundamental group into G. And I just recall in two words how you obtain that. So you know that if you have a complete GD structure, then from the universal covering of your surface, there is a so-called developing map, which is, in fact, a diffeomorphism with D. And now, how do you obtain this homomorphism into the group of isometries of D? Well, you just define, you know, it's the covering transformations as seen in the disk using the developing map, okay? So all this is very familiar. So you forget, what you do is, you have a hyperbolic structure, and it would be reasonable to keep this information, the identification of the universal covering of S with the model space. But in fact, no, you just keep something apparently weaker, which is the holonomy representation, which is an algebraic object, and you look at that map. And now the question is, I mean, the question which has been answered since quite a long time in different ways is characterize the image of delta. I call this delta, I don't know why, probably because it reminds developing in some way. Okay. So here is a completely general fact which is an exercise, okay? Namely that in any case, this map here induces an injection. Yeah. What? No conjugacy. If one does this, the right way to do this is to choose a base point in the tangent space of S and insist that this thing here sends your base point to one specific unit tangent vector here. And then you just work with this. So one should, this discussion should be made with base points in tangent space, otherwise there's a little indeterminacy. Now we want to characterize the image of delta. In any case, what is always true, which I find rather remarkable, if you mod out by the group of diffeomorphisms which you can homotope to the identity, then this, in fact, injects. And this is always so. Okay? So that means, you know, your GD structure, you can change it by precomposing it by diffeomorphisms, right? And you're going to precompose it just by diffeomorphisms which you can move back to the identity. And then this quotient here can be injected in this here. And this is for any surface whatsoever. Okay, but now, of course, I will in the sequel now describe three ways of answering this question. How do I describe this image? And so these three ways will then later on, when we will replace G by a more general Lie group, give different ways of generalizing Teichmuller theory, or parts of it, not the whole of it. Okay, and then when we will have used these different descriptions which give us interesting subsets in the space of homomorphisms of the fundamental group of a surface into a Lie group, then we will come back, in fact, and ask ourselves, well, what replaces the left-hand side, because that will not be clear at all anymore. So this here is the most important map. So I give it some kind of symbol. And when I prepared my talk, I had checked the weather for Bangalore and said it was raining all the time, and it's not true. But so that's umbrella. Okay. So let's leave this. Okay. I'm going to be fast here. The first way to answer the question, well, how can I characterize the image of delta? Is I would call it Fenkel-Nielsen deformation, and I would say that it's at least 100 years old. And I did not check the references, but Riemann already gave an argument that that's much more than 100 years old, why the space of hyperbolic structures has the dimension it has. But okay, so here, this just takes, first I have to say the context. Of course, I will restrict the kind of surfaces I'm looking at. They will not always be compact, but in this case here they will be compact. And compact, for different geometries, one has to add without boundary. So, and in this case, the structure one exploits is very simple. You know that there is a presentation. Mm-hmm. by generators and relations of the fundamental group of such a surface when if G is the genus. And you know, if you take the word presentation seriously, then it gives you immediately a lot of information. It tells you that the homomorphisms, yeah, you don't see here, right? Can I move what back? Ah, this. Oh. Okay. Well, I can continue here. Then we know that the space of homomorphisms, it tells you what is a homomorphism. Well, it's completely determined by what it does on generators. And then the images of these generators has to satisfy one relation, and that's it. So, and here I have described the space of homomorphisms as a closed subset. In fact, a subset given by a certain number of polynomial equations. And in this product here, which is just a real algebraic set. So immediately, we have much more. And this is a real algebraic set. That means it has a topology. It has, one can speak of all kinds of objects associated to that, like connected components. And the theorem is the following. Here is the answer. But this answer supposes that I know one hyperbolic structure, okay? So let's pick one hyperbolic structure. Then all the others are described in that way. This thing here is the connected component of one specific Kulkarni representation in this space. So this is highly, this contains a lot of information already. Because if you just, you know, go from a very general point of view, real algebraic sets, they have connected components. So this will be one of them. They have finitely many connected components. And on top of it, connected components are semi-algebraic. And that means that in order to characterize this thing here inside the space of homomorphism, you need to find finitely many inequalities, polynomial inequalities in the matrix entries in order to get all the equations and inequations describing this. So this gives a lot of information. And these equations and inequalities have been found, and this is the subject of, for example, the papers of Linda Keane. In the 60s, there is one in Analysis of Mathematics where you can really write down complicated inequalities which give you the description of this set. Okay, now we're going to move to the next point of view. Of course, people often look at things like that. I mean, soon we will be talking about surfaces which have finite topological types. So that means there are finitely many holes and finitely many, let's say, ends. There's no metric yet. And in this case, this thing breaks down completely. Why? Because if S is non-compact, the fundamental group is free. Okay. And the space of homomorphism to any group G is just some Cartesian product of G. So it's connected. So don't look for connected components, I mean, because that's the end of that method. So one has to think about something else then. OK, that's Franklin Nielsen. That was, yeah, still OK. Now I move to a second method, which by now is also very classical, No. The area of a representation. And that's so what is this? Well, that's basically Goldman's thesis. I'm going to stay just in a few words. Again, the context is S is compact. And in a sense, this here is going to give you one sort of answer to what was left over here. What was left over here was, well, we know the set of holonomy representations of hyperbolic structures, one connected component of this real algebraic set, find additional equations. Okay, so here it's going to give you an additional equation, which is going on the nose to characterize that set, but at a little price, is that this equation is not going to be so explicit. So the special feature we use here. So before that, we didn't use much about the hyperbolic plane, right? I mean, now we're going to use something about the hyperbolic plane. Namely, that the hyperbolic plane carries an invariant two-form. In fact, the metric here is a Kähler metric. Of course, that sounds stupid to say that in dimension 2, because all Hermitian metrics are Kähler. But it's the word to pronounce. It's it's one kind of framework which allows generalization. So this is a Kähler manifold. That means that this form here is closed. So now the little construction, so we're going to introduce the invariant of a representation, the area of a representation. And I recall in two words what it is. you do the following. So you have a representation of the fundamental group of your surface into G. So remember that's... So that means you have an action on the disk by Poincaré disk by isometries. And now, let's do the following construction. We can pull back this area form on S cross D. Okay. And now, we have the action of gamma on, I'm sorry, this is completely wrong, on the universal covering cross D. And now we have an action of the fundamental group on the universal covering. That's not big news. And we have, via this representation, an action on D, and hence a diagonal action on this space. So we can go to the quotient. That's the quotient. And this quotient is just a fiber bundle with base the surface S, and with fibers the Poincaré disk. So, and this is essentially a theorem historically due to... So there is a smooth section S. And the existence of this smooth section, the history has been traced back by Michel Rodin, is due to a student of R.S. Mann called Jacques Feldbau. So, well, it was not that general, but... still, that goes back to 1941, something like that. So that now, you know, yeah, you have this two form here, and can pull it back here. Introducing notations, we end up with an invariant which is this two form integrated over S, and I should have added that there is a fixed orientation. Okay, and this number has a certain number of properties. It can be interpreted as a characteristic number, and The properties which are relevant are here is let's say first an exercise is that why is this called the area of representation? It's because if we apply this to the holonomy representation of hyperbolic structure, we're going to find 2g minus 2 and that's and this is essentially, you don't need really Gauss-Bonnet. I mean, you need to know what's the area of a triangle in a hyperbolic plane to compute that. Anyway, here are the following facts which one can prove about this invariant. First, this area of representation is locally constant with values in Z. And second, there is an inequality. 2g minus 2 is the maximum possible value which it can attain, and indeed it does so for hyperbolic structures, so that the question which begs to be asked is, well, what is the characterization of this equality case here? And the characterization of the equality case is exactly the answer to the question of characterizing hyperbolic structures. So the theorem, Goldman's theorem, says the following. It's about 1980. Is that representations describing hyperbolic structures, that's the same thing than representations with area equal to 2g minus 2. So this is, in a sense, an answer to the remaining previous question, which was, well, you know, can you give an equation for that component here, you know, for that semi-algebraic set? And that's the equation, and it's not exactly clear, you know, how is this thing here? I mean, one might object, this thing here, is it related? It should be related to the values of the representation on the generators. You know, you have this. I mean, you use these values here to describe this as a semi-algebraic set. As an algebraic set, you should be able to say, well, this number can be computed from matrix entries of the, you know, of the images of the generators. And the answer is yes, it can. This is a little bit more longer story, but the answer is yes, it can. It depends on, you have to go to universal coring of a PSL2R, and there are some signs of the, you know, of the entries which are going to play a role. So this is